I want to invite you to stand to your feet as you get ready to worship God this morning. Amen?
Amen.
But before we do that, why don't you go ahead and greet your neighbor right across from you. Here it goes. I live.
I live by faith and not by sight. I walk with you through day and night. I'm not afraid, no need to hide. All through this life, you're by my side. I live by faith and not by sight. I walk with you through day and night. I'm not afraid, no need to hide. All through the night you're by my side. And I will go, 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 wherever you lead me, wherever you want me. Your ways are higher than mine. I will go, 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 wherever you lead me, wherever you want me. Your ways are higher, higher than mine.
That's it, church. Put your hands together. Here we go. Sing, I live.
I live by faith and not by sight. I walk with you through day and night. I'm not afraid, no need to hide. All through this life, you're by my side. And I will go, 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 wherever you lead me, wherever you want me. Your ways are higher than mine. I will go, 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 wherever you lead me, wherever you want me. Your ways are higher, higher than mine.
I say, church. Woo! Here you go, church. You are.
You are my light, show me the way.
1, 2.
I live on every word you say. It's not a secret that I stay with you forever, all my days.
Let's sing that one more time. Sing, you are.
You are my light, show me the way. Word you say, it's not a secret that I say.
1, 2, 3.
With you forever, all my days. And I will go, 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 wherever you lead me, wherever you want me. Your ways are higher than mine. I will go, 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 wherever you lead me, wherever you want me. Your ways are higher, higher than mine.
Yes, Lord, may that be our heart's cry, that we will go where you call us to go. We would go so without hesitation, Father God, for you are worthy of it all. So, amen. Here you go, sing, you are.
You are my light, show me the way. I live on every word you say. It's not a secret that I say. With you forever, all my days.
Father God, Lord, as we go, Lord, just guide our steps, Father God, and take us upon your eagle's wings, Lord, and guide us and soar us through everything that you have planned for our lives, everything you have planned for our kingdom, your kingdom, Father God. Use us, Lord, as we go and as we meet new people, as we walk across the room, Lord, give us the strength and the courage, Lord, to go talk to your people, to meet new people, to bring your people to your kingdom, Father God, to bring them home, Lord. Yes, Jesus. We will soar on eagle's wings, Father God.
Yeah.
Power and glory.
23, a very familiar one. It says, "The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside still waters. He restores my soul. He leads me in paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of mine enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup overflows. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I shall dwell in the house of the Lord forever." Amen. Brothers and sisters, some of you may be feeling like you're hoping for something, like there is something that you're wanting. Maybe there's a severing in your life. I just feel in my spirit that there's something that you're longing for. And maybe that you're kind of going through a season where you're kind of dried up like a little grape or dried up like a little prune. You know, the word tells us is as we walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I'm here to tell you, and the Holy Spirit wants to remind you, brothers and sisters, that the rains are coming. That the rains are coming where the rivers of living waters will begin to fill you back up again. Brothers and sisters, and you will begin to find that joy that you've been longing for a very long time. If that's you, brothers and sisters, just give them praise. Hallelujah. Amen. I don't know who you are, but I know it's a word for somebody in this room that you're hoping for something. You're longing for something. And you think that you've been walking all alone by yourself through the valley in the darkness, all by yourself, and the Lord is here to tell you that you're not alone, that he's always been with you. Hallelujah. I know that's the word for somebody. If that's you, brothers and sisters, receive it today. Hallelujah. Father God, we come before you. And we make that chorus our prayer this morning, that we will keep our eyes on you, Lord God, to see us through the wind and the rain. Father God, when we cannot see what's ahead of us, you call us forward, Heavenly Father, to follow you, to follow your voice, to have faith in you. And so we come, Heavenly Father, faithfully, not knowing what you're gonna do exactly, but we expect, Lord God, because we are a people of expectation. Because where there is expectations, Lord God, there is the breeding ground for miracles to happen in our lives. Amen? As we are planted in the house of the Lord, we shall flourish in the courts of our God forever and ever. And so we glorify you, Lord Jesus. We praise you in this place, for you inhabit the praises of your people. And so we come to lavish love on you, to lavish our praises on you. Be glorified. In your name we pray. And if that resonates with you, brothers and sisters, go ahead and give a shout. Thank the Lord. Hallelujah. We praise you, Jesus. Amen. For all that you have done in our lives, for all that you are doing in our lives, and for all that you will do in our lives. We praise you, Lord God. Now go ahead and extend the love to one another, brothers and sisters, as we get ready for this morning service. Good morning. God bless you. Hallelujah.
Good morning, everybody. Okay. As everybody takes their seats, I'll introduce myself. My name's Giselle, if you don't know me, and I have some announcements for you guys today. So to start off, I would like to direct everyone to the connection card, just a second, right here. Ooh. This little card right here. And so it's basically just a way for the church to get to know you. If there's anything that you want to get involved in, any way that you want to get connected, this is definitely a way for you to do that. So make sure you fill this out, give it to one of the ushers on your way out. There are also there's also a place for praise reports and prayer requests. And so we have a really great prayer team that looks over these and wants to help you in praying for what you need God to do in your life and how you need God to move in your life. Also to praise God for what he's doing in your life. So definitely take a look at that. You can also go to the back area where we have all those tables. It's a great place to get connected, to just talk to people, fellowship with people, and just have a really great time. So now we have some videos.
New Hope Central Oahu is participating in Give Aloha, Foodland's annual community matching gifts program. Throughout the month of September, customers are invited to make donations up to $249 to the Legacy of Hope campaign at checkout. Individuals must use their own MyCutty card to make a donation. Foodland and the Western Union Foundation will match a portion of each donation made with a MyCutty card. Donations made without a MyCutty card will not be matched. All Give Aloha donations are tax deductible, so save your store receipts for tax purposes, since it will be the only record you will have of your donation. You may ask the cashier for a duplicate receipt. Please encourage your family and friends to shop at Foodland. Extra brochures will be available at Connection Central. Are you ready to go deeper? To connect? To transform? This fall, Transformation Academy. New Hope Central Oahu presents Rosario Ministries. Join us on Friday, September 25th for a benefit concert to raise money for their very first original worship album. See you there.
Okay, so those were the three videos on the Rosario Ministries. So all of you should have these little cards right here. You've been getting them for the past couple of weeks, so hopefully you've been passing them out to some of your friends. We just want you all to come out. It's this Friday at the Rye Center from 7 to 8:30. And we just want everyone to have a good time. We want to usher in the Spirit of God just so we could all come together and worship Him, you know? Okay. Next, for the Grow with NHCO class, if you didn't sign up yet, it's not too late. You can still go. Instead of holding it in the toddler's room, it's actually going to be at the blue tables in the little covered walkway area over there. So make sure you get on that. Also, last thing, if you look at the, what would you call this, like the sleeve thing? I don't know, whatever. Most people don't look at this, but what you don't know is that there's actually a lot of information on here. So make sure you read it. One of the things is this thing called Amazon Smile right over here. And so basically what it is that if you buy something from Amazon, then Amazon will donate some money to our Legacy of Hope campaign. And so ways that you could get other people to do that or share this with other people is on this blue sheet, there's a link to the Amazon Smile. You could also share it as an email, on Facebook, or on Twitter. So we would really appreciate your help in getting that word out. Okay, so that's it for the announcements. I'd like to call up the ushers for tithes and offerings. If this is your first time visiting the church, please feel no obligation to give. Just consider the service as a gift from the church to you. And for those of us that call New Hope Central Oahu or New Hope Haleiwa our home church, just give as the Lord leads. So would you all bow your heads? Dear Heavenly Father, I come to you in the mighty name of Jesus, Lord, and I thank you so much for this beautiful day, God. Thank you so much for everything that you've provided for us, everything that you will provide for us, anything that you have planned for us, Lord. I pray that you would lead your people in giving and that you would lead those that take this money to steward it well so that they may better your kingdom, Lord. In Jesus' name, amen. And now let's welcome Pastor Glenn. Yay.
Hey, good morning, everybody. All right. Well, what a wonderful time of worship we had again this morning. And, you know, I'm just kind of thankful that the weather has gotten a lot better, yeah? You know, of course, we were having, last week, all the storms and all that coming, and we were, of course, wondering which one was going to hit and all that kind of stuff and the humidity that we had and all that. And then, actually, it was this weekend that we didn't know that we were supposed to have church because of the earthquake. Yeah? And so we were kind of scrambling, you know, just kind of getting ready to put our systems into place to make sure that we contact everybody, you know, whether or not we're going to have church. But we were just kind of waiting on administration here at Haleiwa Elementary to find out what they're going to do. Of course, the tsunami never hit. Thank goodness. Thank God. And so we're here this morning. So again, thank you for coming out and worshiping with us. You know, I do want to do a shout out to our family out in Periscope, if you will indulge me, right? Bienvenida y buenos dias. Welcome and good morning to our Spanish-speaking family, right? We also have Portuguese. Let me try this. Mania de boas, vines e boa. Mania de boas, vines e boa. I don't know if I'm butchering it, but welcome and good morning. That's Portuguese. And then I have Priem y dobroya utro, which is welcome and good morning in Russia. Russian. I also try Turkish. Turkey? Wow, yeah. Os ve günaydın. Okay, so I'm sorry if I'm butchering that, but I'll get better. I'll do my best to practice, amen? But welcome and good morning, and I just celebrating technology. that we have. You know, of course, we have just wonderful propeller heads in the, you know, the fuel family, right? Rich and Bradley over there, and just really into technology, and just reminding us once again, as vast as the Earth is, as huge as this planet is, it's really small enough to fit in the palm of God's hands. Amen? And what I mean by that is that I don't know people from different countries and all these kinds of things, but we do have one common denominator, which is Jesus. Amen? And that's why we're able to travel to different countries and we can worship with them. And they're worshiping in entirely different languages, but the Holy Spirit forever remains the same. And it's a beautiful thing. It's a very, very beautiful thing. And so we celebrate that. And as I was looking at this picture, take a look at this picture on the screen. It says, just walk across the room. The title this morning is Living in 3D. So I was looking at this picture, and we can assume he's a man, right? Deductive reasoning, he has hairy legs, as you can see, right? A man walking across, you know, walking down the gravel path, right? But then the title says, just walk across the room. Now, clearly that's not a room. So I said, okay, what the heck is that? Now, I never made this slide. But as I was looking at that, and then I realized that God does not call us to just walk across the room. I mean, certainly it covers that. It's a part of that. But really what the Lord was telling me and telling us, brothers and sisters, is that the world really is our mission field. Amen? So when we're done with service this morning and we're going to go outside, we cross that threshold over there, and we're out in the world now becomes our mission field. Amen? And so that's the message this morning, right? The message is about, really, is about evangelism. Amen? And some of you guys are saying, some of you guys are squirming in your seats, and I know because I'm one of you, squirming in my seats, that when we learned that we were going to do a message like this, that we were called to go out and reach out to people, I didn't want to do it. I'm just not like that. That's not in my nature, you know? And some of you guys are looking at me and say, well, but you're the pastor. I mean, come on. You have the title, right? You're used to this, going out and talking to the unchurched, going out and talking to the people of the world, and all these kinds of things. Yeah, but I'd rather not. Amen? And so the Lord checked me as well. And trust me when I say this, that I recognize that in some of you because I recognize it in myself. So together, as we discuss this, as we learn about this, we just pray that the Holy Spirit gives us the power and the wisdom and the strength to overcome that, amen, and to really get better at this part of our lives. Can I get an amen? Because why? Jesus commanded us. Everybody say, Jesus commanded. Wag a finger at your neighbor and say, Jesus commanded. He commanded. He commanded us. It wasn't a request. He said what? He said, go. Go out and make disciples of the nations. Brothers and sisters, I'm here to tell you, I'm here to ask you, brothers and sisters, what makes up nations? People. The dreaded P word, right? People. And so that's where we're going to take this message today. Amen. And so I want to read from the book of Matthew. Now, it's not going to come up on your screen, but I want to encourage you, if you do have your Bible, to follow along with me. Okay. So this is kind of like the evangelist manual, right? God, I don't know how to evangelize. Well, you have a manual in your hand, dummy. Okay. Right? But I'm going to be reading out of the book of Matthew chapter 10. Matthew chapter 10. And it says this. Man, I need glasses now. Gosh. I've had 20/20 vision all my life, but my eyesight is going. Matthew chapter 10 verse 1. It says, and he called to him his 12 disciples and gave them authority over unclean spirits to cast them out and to heal every disease and every affliction. The names of the 12 apostles are these. First, Simon, who is called Peter, and Andrew, his brother, James, the son of Zebedee, and John, his brother, Philip and Bartholomew, Thomas and Matthew, the tax collector, James, the son of Alphaeus and Thaddeus, Simon the Cananean, and Judas Iscariot, who betrayed him. Okay, now with that list, brothers and sisters, I want to envision your name in that list, okay? So for example, the 12 apostles are these. First, Simon, who is called Peter, Andrew, his brother, Fred of Wahiwa, right? James, the son of Zebedee, Creighton of Mililani, and John, his brother, right? Creighton and his daughter Bree of Mililani. Then you have Thomas and Matthew. Then you have Chris and Lonnie of Mililani Mauka. You see what I mean? So if we add our name in that list, and that's the reason why I believe, you know, when Jesus, you know, he kind of like, he lays out all the names of the generation after generation after generation, because he wants us to understand how important we are to him. We're not just faceless names. We're not just, you know, just people just roaming around with no purpose and no vision. We do matter to him. Amen? Say, I matter to God. And we need to really understand that, because when we do that, we have a healthy understanding of the purpose as to which why we were placed on this earth. Amen? And some of us are, you know, going through a journey. Why was I born? How many of you guys have ever asked yourself that? Why? Yeah. Thank you for being honest. I ask myself that all the time. Why was I born, God? You know, there was this point in my life where I was so dark and heavy and I just had no purpose, and then all of a sudden, bam, right? And we'll get into that a little bit later. And all of a sudden, the clouds broke open. I saw the light, and I'm like, okay, now I know why I was born, Lord. Thank you so much. And it's because that he simply wants us to be part of his story as we develop our stories and share our stories with one another, thereby being able to relate to one another, amen, and being encouraged by one another. Does that make sense? Okay, so as we go on, verse 5, these 12 Jesus sent out, instructing them, go nowhere among the Gentiles and enter no town of the Samaritans, but go rather to the lost sheep of the house of Israel. Everybody say lost sheep. Lost sheep of the house of Israel are the non-believers, I mean, are the chosen people of God that haven't made that decision yet, right? But he's talking about go nowhere among the Gentiles or the Samaritans. Now, the Gentiles are the non-believers. The Samaritans at that time were the enemies of the Jews. Okay, they were kind of hostile toward each other. So Jesus is warning them to not to go near them just yet, because Jesus hasn't gone to the cross yet. He never died yet, and he never rose again yet, okay? So the victory wasn't won yet. But how many of you all know that he has won the victory already, okay? So now everyone, Jews and Gentiles, are now included within the house of the Lord, because we know that Jesus is all-inclusive. He's not exclusive, brothers and sisters. But how many of you sometimes live a life of exclusivity? Right? You only want to hang out with people who you want to hang out with. And I get that. That's how cliques form and all these kinds of things, and you kind of live in your Christian bubble. And we'll talk about that a little bit later. But he's saying, go out, go reach out to the lost sheep of the house of Israel and proclaim as you go, saying the kingdom of heaven is at hand. Heal the sick, raise the dead, cleanse lepers, cast out demons, and cast out demons. Moving to verse 11, whatever town or village you enter, find out who is worthy in it and stay there until you depart. Verse 12, as you enter the house, greet it. And if the house is worthy, let your peace come upon it. But if it is not worthy, let your peace return to you. And if anyone will not receive you or listen to your words, shake off the dust from your feet when you leave the house or town. Truly I say to you, it will be more bearable on the day of judgment for the land of Sodom and Gomorrah than for that town. So what is Jesus saying? Jesus is saying, reach out to the people and share with them the gospel of the good news. Now, some people are going to reject it. That's okay. Shake off the dust from your shoes and move on, okay? Because some people, by the grace, by the gift of free will, some people are going to say yes, some people are going to say no. That's just the reality of what Jesus is teaching us, amen? But here's the thing. Verse 16, and I love this verse. Commit this one to memory. Verse 16, behold, I am sending you out as a sheep in the midst of wolves. So be wise as serpents and innocent as doves. Beware of men, for they will deliver you over to courts and flog you in their synagogues. And you will be dragged before governors and kings for my sake, to bear witness before them and the Gentiles. When they deliver you over, do not be anxious how you are to speak or what you are to say, for what you are to say will be given to you in that hour. For it is not you who speak, but the Spirit of your Father speaking through you. Amen. So how many of you have ever had an encounter with someone and you're like, I don't know what to say to them? Amen. But the Lord does reassure us that go with it. Follow the leading of the Holy Spirit. Follow the prompting of the Holy Spirit. Brothers and sisters, a couple of days ago, most of you know that New Hope Central Oahu is in the middle of a campaign, a building campaign. And I don't know if you guys saw this on TV, KITV. There was a feature, you know, saying that there's a lot of, you know, people in Mililani Mauka that don't quite understand, and that's mildly putting it, they don't quite understand why there's going to be another church up in Mililani Mauka. Now, this church is going to be located right next to the Mililani Middle School, right on Lehiva Drive. So some of you guys are, of course, familiar with that area. And there was close to 300 petitions against wanting us to build church over there. So a lot of people came up and they were, you know, just being confrontational and voicing their opinion as to why, you know, they shouldn't build church over there. And so, but the thing is, they kind of mistaken New Hope Central Oahu with New Hope Oahu. So they got their facts wrong. They said, oh, you know, there's going to be like, you know, thousands and thousands of people up here on Lehiva Drive. No, 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 no. You're mistaking us for the big church downtown. You know, we're a lot smaller than that, of course. But the point is that, you know, Pastor Mike, and he knew that he had to kind of go into the lion's den a little bit. But Pastor Mike, wonderful man of faith, you know, he said, you know, I don't know what to say, but I'll just have to be wise as a serpent, be gentle as a dove, go in there by the Holy Spirit's prompting, and just speak as to what the Father wants him to say. And Pastor Mike did awesome. Just a wonderful senior pastor that he is. We don't know the outcome just yet, but we're standing in faith, brothers and sisters, that the first week in October is when we will get the green light to go. Amen. Is we just believe that this is somewhat of an opposition that we don't take lightly, that we have to address because we want to win the hearts of the community. Does that make sense? Because there's a lot of people that came for us saying just the good that New Hope Central Oahu does in community. So people understand all that, but they're more worried about, you know, the storm drain getting clogged, or they're worried about the traffic that's going to happen every Sunday morning, you know, that type of thing. So if you could keep that in prayer, okay? But the point is, as you go out into the world, as you walk across the room, as you walk across the dusty roads, and you shake your hand, you stick your hand out to people that you don't know, right? Reaching the unchurched. You don't know what to say. Follow the leading of the Holy Spirit, okay? And we'll get into that a little bit more. But living in 3D, how many of you guys are familiar with 3D movies? Right? I think it came out like in the 1950s or whatever. So I used to watch 3D movies when I was growing up. And then later on when I got older, I don't know, my eyes kind of got sensitive to all that, you know, blue and red and all that kind of stuff. And so I wasn't really into 3D movies in my later years, but when I was in South Carolina last year, you know, my friends, you know, to kind of pass the time, we would go to watch 3D movies week after week after week, so I kind of got accustomed to it. And that's when, like, Captain America came out, you know, Captain America in 3D and all this kind of stuff, and so it was a lot of fun. But when we think of three dimensions, brothers and sisters, what are we talking about? We're talking about length and width, right? That's two dimensions. The third dimension is depth, right? So that's the third dimension. We got length, we got width, and we got depth, right? So it makes all the pictures pop out at you and all these kinds of things. So we have a new perspective. Everybody say new perspective. With that new perspective, we get a whole new experience, right? Some of you guys are just, you know, angry all the time. Some of you guys don't understand what's going on, this and this and this. There's a lot of confusion and chaos in our lives sometimes because we don't have enough perspective. And that's why it's important, brothers and sisters, to get around believers such as yourself. And we talked about, you know, having blind spots in our lives. That's why it's important to broaden our minds, broaden our perspective, because God did promise in His Word that His thoughts become our thoughts. Amen. And so as we broaden our minds and gain perspective by the knowledge of God, we are able to overcome certain things in our life. We are able to endure many things in our life, amen? And that's why three dimension, it's a whole new experience for us. When I was a born-again believer, this was my favorite album. And to this day, it's still one of my favorite albums. It's from a group called Acapella. And this song is entitled Brave New World. It has no instruments, it's just strictly voices. Awesome. Highly recommend it, so if you guys want to check it out. The chorus of the song, Brave New World, it says this. It says, welcome to the brave new world. Welcome to the place where you've always longed to be. Welcome to the brave new world. Because once you've seen this joy, you'll never want to leave. This place brings a new dimension in life, because the one in control here is Jesus Christ. So, welcome to the brave new world. And this was a song like 20 years ago when Michael was born, and I was just brand new, born again believer. And I'm like, man, I've never experienced this encounter before. I've never experienced so much joy in my life before. And everything that I was feeling, this song says. Like, whatever I was, you know how sometimes when you feel a certain thing, you don't know how to verbalize it? And this song was it for me. This place brings a new dimension to life, because the one in control here is Jesus Christ. Once you've seen this joy, you'll never want to leave. Amen. That word dimension, brothers and sisters, dimension simply means measure. Just simply means measure. So when you think about it, when we're living in 3D, there's a whole new measure to life. Now, what is this measure to life? Okay, so I want to unpack that a little bit. There's a whole new dimension, a whole new measure to life. Jesus is number one. Okay, you can write this in your side margin someplace. Jesus is number one. Jesus, the center of it all. Hallelujah. If Jesus cannot be in the center of your activities or what you're doing, don't do it, right? Stop it. If Jesus cannot be the center of your activities, don't do that activity. Hallelujah. Jesus is our foundation. Jesus is the foundation on which we build our lives. He is our cornerstone. And so when we are born again, brothers and sisters, right? And a lot of you experience this because I did, and I know I'm not the only one. But when we're born again, we come into this brave new world and we find this joy and we're so excited, right? So there's me, there's you, me, right? And what we do is we build a relationship with Jesus Christ, right? Because Christianity is not a religion, it's not a system of religiosity, but it is a relationship. So we are encouraged to develop that intimacy with Jesus Christ because Jesus Christ knows us, but we have to work towards getting to know Jesus. Amen. The third component to living this life, what I call living a 3D life, is others. Aha. Right? How many of you have ever experienced someone just saying, oh, you know, I don't need anybody else. It's just Jesus and me. I'm fine. Right? I see a lot of heads nodding. Right? Oh, this is Jesus and me. I don't need to go to church. You know, all those church people, they're kind of off a little bit. But I love Jesus. You know, and some people will say, well, you know, those church people, they're hypocrites. How many of you guys have heard that one? Now, can we blame them? Not really. I mean, we really have to check ourselves, brothers and sisters, right? I mean, but they also have to understand that, hey, we're a work in progress, too. So it goes both ways. But you see, that mentality that's outside the church, amen, it's a reality outside. But a lot of people say, well, you know, Jesus and me, I'm good, you know, just leave me alone, I'm done, you know, I read my Bible, I listen to my music, I'm good, leave me alone. But in reality, okay, can you guys see this? Yeah, you guys can see this. Jesus and me, right? So there's a nice, strong connection. There's Jesus and me, right? Jesus is the number one, right? And then you got me. People live in a Christian bubble. Okay, what do I mean by living in a Christian bubble? You wake up to worship music. My son, I don't know, I think it's Braden. Whenever he wakes up, you know, he sets his alarm on his phone, and whenever he wakes up, it's a Christian song. So I'm like, oh, you know. Sometimes he has to wake up earlier than me, then I don't have to wake up, but you know, I'm singing along in my sleep. And then I can't fall back asleep, so I'm angry at him, but you know, I just wake up, I was like, okay, all right, I'll get up to, right? But you wake up to Christian music. What I do is when I take a shower, I have Christian music going on as well, or I listen to a podcast while I'm in the shower. And then, you know, you get into your car, you drive to work, what do you listen to? 95.5, The Fish, right? So you listen to all these Christian dialogues going on. You go to work, you know, you see your coworkers over there, they're not believers over there, so you avoid them, right? Because they got all this negative talk, right? I've been there, done that, and then you go, you wait, you're just waiting for your lunch break. Waiting for your lunch break. So you go to your lunch break, you retreat into your corner, you're over there reading your Bible, you try to do your soap journal, right? You go back to your desk or whatever it is. What are they listening to? KSSK, right? Oh, can we change the channel to 95.5? No. You know, they get mad at you because you're the Christian, right? For years, I was the Christian guy when I was in the military, right? You come home, you listen to 95.5, The Fish, you shower, you get ready, you're still listening to worship music, and then you go to your Ohana group at night, right? It's a beautiful thing. But, you know, we get caught up in living in this Christian bubble, right? And the Lord is telling us to slip that cocoon, get out of that cocoon, right? And go reach the unreached. Why? Because of Matthew 28:19, which says, go and make disciples of all nations, right? Go bring the lost sheep of the house of Israel and bring them into the house, okay? So a lot of us get into a habit of come. We have the come mentality. Come to church. But I'm here to tell you, brothers and sisters, you got to go before you can say come. Hallelujah. And the devil comes in because you have this Jesus and me mentality, right? So the devil comes in, and I'll change colors here. The devil comes in and tries to build a wedge between you or me and others, right? Because you're living that Jesus and me mentality. When in reality, Jesus is saying, no, go make disciples of all nations. Go make that connection with others. You see that? Make that connection with the sole purpose, brothers and sisters, of introducing the unchurched to the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, thereby inviting them into the house of the Lord. Can I get an amen? So you see that. The three components of living a 3D life. Hallelujah. Oops. Not too crazy. Okay, so turn to your neighbor and say, you got to pop your bubble. You got to pop that Christian bubble. Okay, you gotta pop it, live outside that bubble. All right, I don't know if you guys remember that movie from John Travolta, The Boy in the Bubble. That was way back when, yeah, way back in the day. All right, living in that bubble. Book of Esther. It was her uncle Mordecai, and I love this phrase, and I pray that you also commit this one to memory. When he said, if you keep quiet at a time like this, deliverance and relief for the Jews will arise from some other place, but you and your relatives will die. Who knows if perhaps you were made queen for just such a time as this? Everybody say that, such a time as this. Meaning that God works in perfect timing. So if there is someone that the Lord wants you to talk to, whether it's a coworker, whether it's a family member, whether it's a friend, the only person, have you ever thought about that, brothers and sisters? The only person that can reach that person is you. For such a time as this. And I love this because, you know, Esther, who was a Hebrew, right, became the wife of the king, basically of the enemy people, right? And so Mordecai is reminding her, for such a time as this, you are now grafted into the family so you can influence them for the good. Amen. So think of your coworkers, think of your family members, think of the unchurched, think of the unloved. Remember that. For such a time as this. Go ahead and write in your notes, live the 3D life by developing relationships. That's the first D. The first D, developing. Developing relationships. Oh, you New Hopers, you guys are all about relationships. Yeah. Jesus said so. Jesus exemplified that. Hallelujah. Verse 16 again, behold, I am sending you out as sheep in the midst of wolves. So be wise as serpents and innocent as doves. Now I appreciate that Jesus never held back. I appreciate that Jesus always told the truth, and he was warning us about what was to come. That persecution will come. That persecution may come. So what am I saying? When you go out there and you reach out to other people, brothers and sisters, right? Have you ever watched National Geographic and you saw a wolf pack just kind of tear a little animal apart? It's pretty graphic, right? And so, you know, Jesus never pulled any punches. He said, that's what it's going to be like sometimes. Amen? So when we go out there is an element of risk, right? There is an element of this person may reject me. There is an element of this person may give me stink eye. Right? There is an element of this person may say, you know, what you doing over here? Get away from me. Or something like that, right? But we still have to go before God, for God. Amen. There is an element of that person may receive me. There is a chance that that person may welcome me. That there is a chance that that person will welcome me with open arms. Amen. How many of you have ever had that experience? I did, yeah. It's scary. And that's why last week, right? Last week, didn't we talk about going into the zone of the unknown? You remember that? Going into the zone of the unknown, because you don't know. But I'm here to tell you, brothers and sisters, that you have a 50-50 chance, right? And that there is that sense of urgency. This past couple of weeks, No, actually, this just happened last week. I was working out at the gym, and, kind of backpedal a little bit, but Emmett, our youngest son, he loves music. I mean, go figure, right? I mean, he's growing up in a musical family, but we're interested to see what kind of tastes in music that he's developing, okay? And so we're kind of pushing different music at him. We try like rap, Christian rap. We tried, you know, like rock music. He likes all that energetic stuff. And then so one time I tried playing like Hawaiian music, you know, reggae, island music, all this kind of stuff. And he likes the stuff, right? So, you know, we're driving along, right? And he's like crying, rah, rah. He's getting all fussy in the back seat. And he's in his car seat, and I put on like Hawaiian music, and he's like, and he's just grooving on the stuff. So one day, you know, I'm like, okay, I'm gonna go online and I'm gonna go buy, you know, maybe other albums. I'm gonna go look for other albums, all that good stuff, and, you know, make sure he likes the feel of the music, the groove of the music, all this kind of stuff. So I find one particular album, okay, because it had like 5 stars. So I buy it, just cause. And so whenever I take Emmett out to the beach, you know, we drive from Mililani to the North Shore and go hang out at the beach, you know, I'm playing the song and then I'm looking in my rearview mirror, right? And he's over there just kind of just cruising along. I'm like, okay, this is good. So I listen to that album almost every day, okay? Now, it's not a Christian album, okay, but it's kind of PG-13. I gotta admit, it's kind of PG-13, but it's very witty, it's good writing, and, you know, I like the instrumentation and all that kind of stuff. But anyway, so I'm working out at this gym, and the guy that walks in happens to be the guy that made the album. That's his album. I mean, he's a local artist. He's also a surfer, okay? He's a local artist, and he lives out here on the North Shore. So I'm thinking, whoa, there he is, right? So I walk over to him. I walk across the room, right? And I shake his hand. I say, what's up, man? I call him by name. And I said, hey, I just want to let you know that I enjoy your album. I listen to it almost every day. You're coming out with another one, right? He goes, yeah, I'm coming out with another one. We're actually working on it right now. He says, yeah, man, keep going. You know, I love your stuff. He's like, okay, yeah, thanks. And he was all like happy and all that kind of stuff. The reason why I did that, brothers and sisters, and, you know, I thought about that afterwards, and I was like, why did I do that? So I thought, well, not because I wanted a story for Walk Across the Room, but I was just thinking, I just wanted to go encourage him. From one artist to another, I just wanted to say, hey, man, your album brings me joy. You know, great job. Thank you so much. You know, because, you know, when you write music as an artist, you want people to enjoy it, of course, right? So I just wanted to encourage him and say, hey, man, yeah, keep going. And so when after that, I was done, and I was thinking, you know, one of these days, he could very well, he could very well walk into church. And that was kind of an afterthought. But I thought, you know, I don't know what kind of faith he's walking. I don't know if he's a Christian or not. I don't know. If I were to say his name, many of you would recognize who he was. It's not Jack Johnson, okay? But many of you would recognize who he is. And he lives out here in the North Shore, and one day he could probably just come in indiscreetly and just fellowship with us. And so I wanted to make that initial contact and say, hey, you're the guy that, yeah, I'm the guy, you know, and kind of make that contact. But the point I'm trying to make is this. I wasn't trying to shove the gospel down his throat. It wasn't the right time. We were in the gym, all the music was blaring, everybody was walking around, you got all the weights clanking around and all this kind of stuff. But I wanted to make initial contact. Everybody say contact. Because when you make initial contact, you have to make contact in order to make impact. Okay? You gotta make contact so you can make an impact in someone's life. Last week we talked about, you know, getting out of your comfort zone and getting into the zone of the unknown. Well, I'm here to tell you, brothers and sisters, you gotta get out of your comfort zone in order to get into the impact zone. You gotta impact other people's lives with the gospel, okay? What does impact mean? Impact means the action of one object coming forcibly into contact with another. So you gotta make contact in order to make impact. Amen. What does impact mean? Bam! You know, but again, you know, it sounds like I'm contradicting myself, but I'm not there. I wasn't there to, you know, beat him over the head with my Bible. I wasn't there to shove the gospel down his throat. Okay, but I wanted to make a friend. Because how many of you know that it takes several plumerias to complete a lay? Does that make sense? Right? I'm not going to be the one to seal the deal. I may not be the one to seal the deal, but I just put another plumeria in his garland. Somebody else is going to come along, put another plumeria in his garland. Okay? Some of them is going to, like, you know, take care of those plumerias and all, and then one of you, perhaps, will come in and then now tie that knot on that lay, and that is the day when he's going to say, Jesus Christ, you are my Lord. Amen? So we're not here to shove the gospel down their throat. We're here to relate to people. We're here to develop relationships. Amen? So get out of your comfort zone, get into the impact zone, and change the life of somebody you know. And if he does come into church, I'll let you know. Amen? The second D, live the 3D life by discovering stories. Write in your notes. You live the 3D life by discovering stories. Proverbs 1:5 tells us, the wise will pay attention to these words and will grow in learning. And the discerning will receive divine guidance. The wise will pay attention to these words. Now, what are these words? I just want to make it clear that these words is referring to the Word of God. Okay? But when you are listening to other people, I want to encourage you to first learn their story before you share them yours. Before you share them the story of redemption as well. Amen. Like, for example, I know Carl and Maureen are from Montana. Why did they come to Hawaii? I have no idea. No, I do know that. It's because they wanted to live in someplace warm, okay? But I had to ask them, why did you leave Montana? Montana's beautiful. You got the lush green forests, you got the fresh clean air, you got those meadows, you got those just amazing animals roaming around and all this kind of stuff. Beautiful, why do you leave Montana? And it's, because it's too cold, you know? And I get that, right? But I had to engage in conversation with them in order to learn their story. And they love it here in Hawaii, and they go back to Montana every year, right? And so it's a wonderful thing. But learning each other's stories, again, it gives you perspective as to why maybe sometimes these things happen in your life as well, right? I love what Mark Twain said. He said, 20 years from now, you will be more disappointed by the things that you didn't do than by the ones that you did do. So throw off the bowline, sail away from the safe harbor, catch the trade winds in your sails, explore, dream, and discover. Well, what does that mean? It means to always maintain an attitude of learning. It always maintain an attitude of, I want to say, curiosity. You know, that may not be the exact word I'm looking for, but just be curious as to why did you do this? You know, why is this happening in your life? Tell me about it, right? Discovering, you know, why do you think this way? Why did you do this? How did you, why do you live a life like that? What did you do? How did the Holy Spirit move in your life? How did you encounter Jesus? Tell me about it, right? When you maintain that attitude, you watch how many friends you make, right? How many of you all know that you have two ears and a mouth? You've probably heard this all the time. You have two ears and a mouth for a reason, which tells us that you have to listen at least twice as much as you talk, right? Some of you guys talk too much. Some of you guys don't listen enough, right? Amen? But discovering stories. You got to find the common ground to take others to higher ground. Higher ground meaning you lead them to Jesus. Amen? Some of you guys, you know, you're finding friends, people that you care about, who what the Bible says that are stuck in the miry clay. And what you're doing is you're reaching out to them and you're talking story with them and you're finding common ground. That's a good thing. That's the first step. And then you point them upwards toward Jesus. You find common ground to take others to higher ground. Some of you guys don't know how to start a conversation. Well, here's a tool that I learned, okay, and it works. Some of you guys are saying, but Pastor, you know, you guys are all on stage and everybody sees you and everybody talks to you and you have no problems making friends. Well, yeah, now. I had to learn it. Trust me, brothers and sisters. I have a friend who always says that he's a typical shy Japanese guy. A friend of mine always says that. I was the typical shy Japanese guy. But I'm here to tell you, I was the typical shy Filipino guy. I didn't want to talk with anybody. I was more content just hiding back there someplace, not talking to anybody. I was happy. You know, and every time I would get up on stage, I would, or not on stage, but public speaking, I was so fearful of public speaking. I was so fearful of just looking people in the eye. You know, I did come from there. And so when I was learned, when I was taught form, it made so much sense to me because it gave me a guideline to engage in conversation. Okay, so let's get started. What is F? F stands for family. So you walk across the room, right, and you don't know what to talk about. You say, hey, good to meet you. My name is Glenn. What's your name? Are you here alone, or are you here with your wife, or are you here with your girlfriend, right, your significant other, right? Family. How many kids do you have, right? Where do you live? Oh, you live out here in Wailua? Awesome. Okay. Did you grow up here? You know, all these different kinds of questions. One question, they'll answer, it'll lead to another question, so on and so forth, okay? O, right in your notes, stands for occupation. Where do you work? What do? Oh, you work for Pearl Harbor Shipyard. Do you know so-and-so? Right? We get into that. Where did you grow up? Oh, I grew up in Pupukea. Oh, did you go to Kahuku? Do you know so-and-so? Right? And just talk story like that. Now, I know I'm preaching to the choir because here in Hawaii, we're masters at talking story, right? But in case you're, you know, you're thinking too much and you're nervous, just remember form, okay? Occupation. Oh, I don't work. I'm only a student. Well, being a student is still an occupation, right? R, what do you like to do for fun? Oh, you don't surf? You grew up in Hawaii, but you don't know how to swim? You know, I've had friends like that too. I like to go hiking. Oh, okay. Where do you like to hike? Manoa Trail, you know, Haula Trail, you know, over by Schofield. Oh. Right? Cocoa Head Trail, right? All these kinds of things. What do you like to do for fun? Okay. And then, of course, the message, brothers and sisters, is sharing the gospel with them. Okay. Now, I'm here to tell you to keep it fluid. Okay. Don't just go, oh, I got to start off with F. You know, Pastor Glenn said to start off with F. No. Maybe you're going to start off with O. You know, where do you work? That's what you have in common. Maybe you guys work together, or you know somebody that works in the same profession that you do. So maybe you might go ORF, you might go OFR, okay? But don't be pressured like you gotta say, hey, you need to receive Jesus in your life right now. Don't feel pressured to do that, okay? Is everybody good? Form. The next D, the third D, okay? So we talked about developing relationships, we talked about discovering their stories, and now we have to discern what the next steps are. What does that mean? Next steps are, do we invite them to an Ohana group? Do we invite them to a bridge event? The bridge event. And that's why I appreciate Danette and Kimo's ministry, because they did wonderful things with bridge events, like through softball. They evangelized through softball. So many people came to the Lord because of different bridge events like that. People who are unchurched, and then they would say, oh, you know what? Just come on and play softball with us, right? And next thing you know, these people are now, receiving the Lord into their hearts, and now they're meaningfully connected in a church someplace, okay? But again, you have to be wise as a serpent, and you have to be gentle as a dove, and you have to know what these next steps are by the leading of the Holy Spirit, okay? Proverbs 16:9 says, we can make our plans, but the Lord determines our steps. Okay, so don't force it. Don't force it. Psalm 34:8 says, taste of his goodness. See how wonderful the eternal truly is. Anyone who puts trust in him will be blessed and comforted. And the message here simply is, let them taste it before they feast on it. Let them taste it before they feast on it. Again, you don't want to shove the gospel down their throat. You know, you got to be wise as serpents, gentle as a dove. Okay. And we're going to finish up with this, and I want to finish up with a video afterwards. So this is kind of fun. We'll end with this. 10 commandments of human relations. Speak to people. There is nothing as nice as a cheerful word of greeting. You know, like that guy that I met at the gym. I just wanted to encourage him. That's all. And hopefully I'll see him again and develop a relationship and engage in another conversation, right? Smile at people. It takes 72 muscles to frown, only 14 to smile. Number 3, call people by name. It is music to anyone's ears. Number 4, be friendly, be helpful. Number 5, be cordial. Speak and act with genuine pleasure. If not, learn to make it so. Okay, we're not saying fake it till you make it, but really, you know, look into the eyes of the people, look into their eyeballs, look into their soul, and connect with them, okay? And realize that they're a human being, amen? Number 6, be genuinely interested in people. You can like almost everybody if you try. They can also like you. Number 7, be generous with praise, cautious with criticism, okay? Everybody can always criticize somebody, okay? Be considerate of others' feelings. There are usually 3 sides to controversy: yours, the other person's, and the truth. Amen? Be alert to serve. What counts most in life is what we do for others. Even it's a simple word of encouragement. 10, add to all this a sense of humor. A big dose of patience, a dash of humility, and you will be rewarded abundantly through life. Amen. And so with that said, brothers and sisters, are you guys ready for the video? Yeah. Okay, so this past Labor Day, right? How many people were baptized? Yeah, I don't want to, 28? 26? 23? 23 people. Can we give the Lord a hand clap, brothers and sisters? So that's 23 people among all the 3 campuses that we have, okay? But I want you to realize this, brothers and sisters, that for those people to come to Christ, it had to take one person to walk across the room and make contact. And because they made contact, everybody, their life is impacted forever and ever and ever for all eternity. Amen. And so the Lord is asking all of us to do that. Now we're going to watch this video, and I want you to enjoy the fruit of our labor as we glorify Jesus Christ together. Amen. I'm clap. It truly was a glorious, glorious day, and I had so much fun. And, you know, a couple of days after that, my body was still sore because we were playing so much. Frisbee, football, and some of the boys, we went boogie boarding and all that kind of stuff. It was a lot of fun. And I want to encourage you guys to come out and enjoy a day like that with us. I'm not sure when the next one is going to be, but we can even make our own. So, but anyway, what a glorious, glorious day. Amen. And so sometimes when we're out there and we're reaching out to people and we don't exactly know, am I doing enough? Amen. And I'm here to tell you, brothers and sisters, that you don't have to strive to anything. You just be you. Amen. And just allow the Lord to work through you. So as we pray, we're going to go into a time of prayer. And I'm just going to go speak to the Lord. I'm not exactly sure what I'm going to say, but I'm just so filled right now with the joy of the Lord, and I just pray that that joy will just spill on to all of you and as we celebrate His goodness. Amen. Father God, we come before You and we thank You so much for what You are doing in our midst. We celebrate, Lord, Your Lordship in our lives. And a lot of us can think back to how we were back then before we came to know You, Lord Jesus. And of course, we don't want to ever go back there. But as we celebrate, Lord God, we know we're not perfect. We know we're not. We know we stumble. We know we fall. We know we sin. We know sometimes, Lord God, we get tempted by the enemy. But Lord God, we just pray Your continued strength in our lives, that we don't fall to the enemy, but instead we fall to our knees in humility as Jesus Christ. You are our Lord. You are our Master. And when You say go, Lord Jesus, we are not slow. It's pip, 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 and away we go. Hallelujah. So Heavenly Father, we thank You so much for all the souls that say yes to You. Because we remember, Lord God, what it was like when we said yes to You. And we want that joy for everyone we come into contact with. We want that joy for them. But we cannot decide for them, amen? And so it is our prayer that as we go out and as we live our lives, that we are not contriving anything, that we're not pretending to be somebody that we're not, but we genuinely are who we are because of You. You are the vine, we are the branches. And only in You, Lord Jesus, we are able to bear fruit. And Lord God, we want to bear fruit for You. Because we know that souls are at stake. There is a sense of urgency, yes. But we also know that You are sovereign, Lord God, as You establish Your kingdom here on earth. And so, brothers and sisters, if you are here this morning and you haven't placed your faith in our Lord Jesus Christ, I want to make sure that we give you an opportunity to do so. If you do not know the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, I'm here to tell you that Jesus Christ is the Alpha, the Omega. He is the beginning and the end. He is the Aleph and the Tav and everything in between. He is our all in all. And in Him, we find peace, grace, love, restoration, victory, light, all those wonderful things we ever need in life. If that's you, brothers and sisters, and He's tugging on your heart right now, you need to respond to Him. If that's you, just go ahead and raise your hand, brothers and sisters. We want to make sure we get that right. Hallelujah. Amen. Amen. If you're here, brothers and sisters, and maybe you've been walking with the Lord for a while, for whatever reason, you know, temptations come our way. It happens. Certainly we've been there, done that. And maybe you've made the mistake of responding to these temptations. And the Lord is calling you back. Come back. Come back. Come back home. Just like when Jesus told us in his word, call back the lost sheep of Israel. Call back the lost sheep to our house. If that's you, brothers and sisters, and the Holy Spirit is tugging at your heart right now, just go ahead and raise your hand. Respond to him. Reach out to him. He's reaching out to you. Hallelujah. Repeat after me, brothers and sisters. Lord Jesus, I know that you love me. And you want to always take care of me. I believe you died and rose for me. I want to live for you. Please come into my heart. Make me your child. Thank you for the forgiveness of my sins. Make me whole again. Restore me. Because I know, Heavenly Father, I know I bring you joy. Thank you that I can live forever with you. I love you, Jesus. Amen.